Hey guys, welcome back to MaxPlain Tone of War Unification. Today I have a faction guide for you for the Dark Elder. So from the Emperor's Triton, the Slaaneshi loving Chaos boys, we are now to the Dark Elder, which are kind of the Chaos Elder, you could say. Also big fans of Slaanesh and his stuff, what he does. So they are basically your Bad Elder, your edgy elves. They are also called they have a very strong offense but are very fragile, so this is a thing that you will see throughout their whole roster. So really, really good at offense, not as good in defense. Have some nice special mechanics as well, which we go through in a minute. So see you in the save game. And here we are, seeing the whole unit roster of Dark Elder. They don't have the biggest pool of units, but they are all very unique. But before we go into that, we will talk about the resources. And the resources for the most part are pretty standard. You have requisition, you have power, you acquire them the ways you would think of, capping strategic points, building listening posts, getting upgrades. Same for power, you're building plasma generators, thermal plasma generators, and getting upgrades and whatnot. But you see here at the bottom that there is also a third resource. That's their soul power, is it called, right? Soul Essence. The Soul Essence is used for your global abilities. You have six global abilities. I will go through the abilities in a second. You acquire this by having your worker or later also a vehicle use this Harvest Soul Essence ability. You can get it either from upgraded slave chamber, which generates corpses, you could say. But also any corpse, any living corpse, every enemy leaving a corpse also leaves you with soul essence for, it stays around for quite a bit, so you can get your torture slave going around getting this resource. It goes up really slowly, so you either need to take a lot of time or you need to get multiple slaves. I think you can get up to four on the field. I think one slave chamber produces enough corpses for one torture slave if it starts immediately. Not sure, to be honest. For the unit caps, it's also a little special. You start off with eight squad cap and three vehicle cap. You can get up to the standard 2020. You start with three vehicle cap because you can get vehicles in tier 1, and this makes them viable. So you can get three vehicles in tier 1 without building vehicle increasing stuff. Vehicle cap increasing stuff. Cap increasing stuff are the slave chambers. You can place them anywhere on the map, increase, and they increase your squad cap and vehicle cap by 3. So it's a little similar to the warp gate mechanic of the standard elder. Also, your Titan production building, the Shadow Gate, gives you plus 4 vehicle cap, as does most Titan producing buildings. Before we go through the buildings, I will quickly go through the global abilities you have. In these two, one are tier 1 abilities. It's Piercing Vision that grants an squad or vehicle true sight for 30 seconds, costs 40 soul essence. You start off with 50, so you can immediately use that when needed. It is needed as you don't have any true sight except for strategic points. So you need this ability in early game if you fight against, let's say, Tau or other factions that use infiltrated squads. Then you have Screams of the Damned. That's a really good global ability as well, as it is against all enemy units. It reduces the morale of all units on the field. It's actually halving the max morale of all squads, enemy squads, and then giving them also some morale damage afterwards. So it's like 50 or 60 morale damage, so really easy to break enemy morale with that. That being said, there aren't a lot of anti-morale weaponry for Dark Elder to begin with, though. When you're already fighting or something, you can use this to damage down the enemy morale even more if you have already damaged a bit, and then maybe can break some squads. Your tier 2 abilities are Rend Soul. That's an ability that's used single target. It disables abilities and causes damage. It causes damage in the beginning, then over the time of 20 seconds, and then damage in the end as well. It's also morale damage as well. So it lasts 20 seconds. If it's cast on a squad, it prioritizes squad leaders or attached heroes. So you can use it on enemy squad hero, you could say. The second tier 2 ability is Corrosion. That's an corrosive cloud. We can actually cast it somewhere. It's an AoE, which in which, how should I call it? Units caught in this will have the armor reduced by 8%, so they take more damage, and also they get a debuff which increases damage taken by 10%. Also, so it's about, let's say, 20% damage increase. It only affects the squad it initially hits. Units moving inside are not affected. It's about 10 or 20 seconds, I don't know really. Rekindle Rage. Rekindle Rage resets all ability cooldowns on one of your units. Really, really nice to have. There's a little bug associated to it with one of the squads here. I will see if I can reproduce that here in the video. And the last one is also the name of the expansion, the last expansion of Dawn of War, Soulstorm. Creates a big Soulstorm dealing quite a lot of damage. It's dealing 4 ticks per second and dealing about 5 damage. I have recalculated it for how much damage it does against infantry. Yeah, like 440 damage against infantry, a little less against vehicles. Lasts for 20 seconds. You can cast it on the ground and then you can actually move it. So if the enemy retreats, move after him. Don't forget about it. It's really costs the arm and a leg in soul essence and can deal very good, especially against enemies, factions that have a lot of units with low HP. So for example, Imperial Guard or Steel Legion and all the different guard factions. So this is the global abilities. We will now talk about the buildings. You have your HQ. I have here all the HQ tech, tier 1, tier 2, tier 3, but they have no visual difference, at least that I can see, so that's a little sad, because as an opponent going inside, scouting the enemy base does not reveal you what he's going for. In tier 1 you have the choice to build 2 unit production building, either the Hall of Blood for infantry or the Dark Foundry for vehicles, but also one infantry squad. So it's, you have the choice right from the get-go. All your infantry here, you get all your vehicles and also a Hellion Squad, which is a jump troop infantry you can get here as well. And then you can get also the Homunculus Laboratory, which is your one of your 2 research buildings, giving you also access to quite a lot of units. Also is the, how should I say, the requirement for all the different squad leaders. So you can get all your squad leaders in tier 1.5, which is really early. Including with some squad leader weapon upgrades, so you can have a really good impact in tier 1 with Dark Elder. That said, their tier 2 is a little... well, it's also really good, I should say. You get access to a variety of vehicles and 2 new squads. But need for some of them the Witch Cult Arena, which is another research building which has researches for your heroes, 3 spells, and also the standard heroes get more HP upgrade, 2 stages of that. That's basically tier 2. Tier 3, you don't get any additional buildings, you get additional squads available from your different productions. And to go from tier 3 to tier 4, you need to build a soul cage. A soul cage itself does not have any abilities or whatsoever, just place it somewhere safe. If possible, it's your tier 4 building. If you have tier 4, you can then also build the Shadow Gate, which is your Titan production building, giving you access to your Titan, which is actually your flying unit, and your Titan Killer unit. So 2 units being able to produce there. Some words about your defense capabilities. You can't build towers, but you have listening posts that can be upgraded twice. So they are really infant infantry, but can also get, once they have the first upgrade, bright lances attached to them. So they have like three rifles times two, a really, really big damage output from your towers. So they're anti-infantry and anti-vehicle. So really good to have, if you ask me. The bright lance upgrade is also really cheap, so nice to have. Your slave chambers increase your cap, as I already told you. They can be upgraded in two ways. One is your torture chamber, which is the one where you get soul essence from. But also your slave chamber is, what is it called? The gruesome display add-on. Here's the torture bit and gruesome display. The gruesome display has a morale decreasing aura, I think, around it, and also has this ability soul shock, which is not unsimilar to the blood pulse of World Eaters. So this is the origin for it. It says it sacrifices a slave, but it doesn't cost anything. It just has a cooldown. If enemies are around, click on it and they will get damaged. Yeah, nothing really special about your generators to produce the standard 10. It's decayed, that's why it's only plus 8. Yeah, that's about buildings, I guess. You get some special buildings in survival, of course. You get a turret there. You, if you have one, that's very special. I should have enabled it here. If you have enabled Hazards and Booby Traps ability, you get one of the prisoner cells, you know, from campaign that produces that produces corpses. And if it's defeated, there is a little uncontrollable warp beast pack there. Lesser warp beasts, they are called. So funny, but not really viable in any ways if you cannot build them. Yeah, one thing about buildings is that the buildings are built themselves. If you have this torture slave and build, for example, a slave chamber, it reminds me of something I want to tell you. He can now go back, harvest some souls, and this will get built by itself. This is the origin we have in Unification, like Thousand Suns and Chaos Demons, for example. Their buildings also build themselves once they are ticked, you could say. This is the first faction who has that going for it. One thing about the slave chamber, it can be built anywhere and has a, which we don't see because we have the listening post here, has quite a large area to build stuff within. So if you want to build a forward base, for whatever reason, you need to build a slave chamber first. That is the units out of the way. Let's go over to the units. We will start always with the builder unit, that's the tortured slave. The tortured slave can build, can repair, can harvest souls. You won't get a lot of these in the beginning because the buildings built by themselves, so you can get away in the early game with one. Later, if you want to harvest some souls and have bigger maps, you may need more later on. Your primary hero unit is the Archon. The Archon starts with just himself and not all this weird, let's say weird looking war gear you can get. He is quite tanky for a Dark Elder, has the ability Animus Vitae, which does some minor damage to your enemy squad, stuns them, or not stuns, roots them for 2 seconds and also leeches some health. Really useful, especially the leeching part. If you use it against a squad, it's 16 health per second over the course of 2 seconds, and it's for all models. So if you have a big guardsman squad, use it, you can restore quite a lot of health. He is able to get incubi. Incubus is by itself quite a good unit. It has really, really good damage spread in ranged and melee against pretty much all armor types, including big buildings and demons and whatnot, so really versatile in that. It also decreases the cooldown for the abilities of the Archon. Sorry about that. You start off with the ability to add one to your squad, but there are abilities that increase the amount you can get in the squad and also the health and damage of the incubi. So if you go with the Archon, I would highly suggest to get the upgrade. It's cheap and makes the Archon so much more viable. If you get the ability from your Witch Guild arena, you get Crucible of Malediction. That's basically a confuse ability to one squad. They will fight each other for about 6 seconds, I think. Yes, 6 seconds, and can use some abilities, but only if they are not targeted. Basically, the enemy loses control of them. The War Gear, which you can get if you enable the option, gives you new weapons and stuff, but also gives you this mask here, which is a morale decreasing aura around him, and Haywire Bombs. Are they on his belt? They should be somewhere on his belt. Not sure if it's on the actual model. Here, these two. These are two Haywire Bombs. These are anti-vehicle, anti-building stuff. Very similar to the Haywire Bombs that Warp Spiders of Eldar have access to. There's also one War Gear, which is the Tormentor Helm, that increases the range damage of your Incubi. Really useful. That's the first hero, and your second and last hero you have access to is the Homunculus. The Homunculus is a very weird, torture-liking guy. He's the one with the most morale damage out of all squads of the Dark Elder. He has quite good DPS. It's really frail in the beginning, so you need to attach him to a squad, I would recommend. He has really good abilities, especially the first one, the Torture Amp. He can stand send here, and it does what does it do? Does it states slows movement and increases attack speed. Slows movement and attack speed of nearby enemy squads. I think the wiki page states that it increases attack speed of your units, but it may be wrong. So it's a debuff area around this Torture Amp. The Torture Amp will stay there for 2 minutes. The cooldown is 80 or 90 seconds, so I don't know if you can have two, I guess so. So yeah, if you see that as playing against Dark Elder, kill this immediately. It only has 100 HP, so it goes down quite quickly. The second one is a Stinger. That's a single target ability, targeting the enemy model. It does quite a lot of damage, and if the model dies within the 20 seconds or what it is last, it will explode, dealing damage around as well. The last one I wouldn't go for in any game, to be honest. It causes souls of nearby fallen troops to explode in a final burst of destructive power. Basically, these souls here, if you click it, they will explode and deal damage. Maybe good if you have like a big fight going on and killed some models, then you click on it and so. Yeah, it's basically a corpse explosion. It's very situational. For the most part, I wouldn't go for it. Could be useful if, for example, against Tyranids, maybe, if they have a lot of brutes against you, like the small brutes jumping at you and you killed some and they're still fighting. You click this and they just are dead. But this is a tier 2 upgrade, so by this point, yeah. I don't know, not the ability I would go for. That's the heroes out of the way. Let's talk about infantry. And there are quite a lot of cool infantry. The first one you can get from your HQ is the Mandrake. The Mandrake is high damage, low HP, as for most Dark Elder units. It does okay in melee. It's your primary capping squad. For that, it's quite expensive with 150 requisition. But you can get infiltration ability for this in tier 1, and also can get a tier 2 upgrade, which increases their damage and health. Give me a second. Melee damage and health. So they are melee only as well, so very situational. If you go for more than 2 of them, get the infiltration ability. In general, it does not hurt to get it. It's cheap and it allows you to cap better. You have 2 options for T1. I told you, you get the Hall of Blood or the Dark Foundry. If you go for the Hall of Blood, you get access to the Warrior Squad. The Warrior Squad is your tier 1 anti-infantry. They have not the greatest range. It's about 22. I'm not sure if it's accurate here because of the leader, but it's 22. It's lower than a standard bolter. They have really high DPS, but are frail. They can get their leader. If you have the Homunculus Laboratory, they can get these 2 weapons if you get the Dark Foundry. These weapons are a little too strong for tier 1. If you ask me, especially the Strutter rifle increases their range from 22 to 30, which is quite a bit. That's their only, or let's say, their biggest weakness out of the way. If you have the Strutter rifle and it doubles, at least doubles their damage output against all enemy armor types. So I don't think this should be in tier 1, if you ask me. I mean, that's only 3, but still. The second one, Dark Matter Blaster, is good against all targets and morale, and thus it states actual damage is proportional to target size, which is not true by itself. It is proportionally better the higher the armor rank is. Let's say if you have a vehicle low, vehicle medium, and vehicle high, it will deal more damage, or proportional more damage, to the higher armor types. Normally the damage does go down the higher the armor type is for most weapons. For this one, I'm not sure, I need to look it up, if it stays the same, which would by itself be really good, or if it's even increasing the damage if you say fight a Baneblade instead of a Lehman Russ, for example. It does a AoE of 4 as well. The range is also bigger than the standard range. 27 has a minimum firing range of 4. In general, I would prefer the Shredder rifle. It's also cheaper in power, so go with the Shredder rifle. The second tier 1 squad you have access to are your Hellion squad from your Dark Foundry. You build them immediately, have two models in the start, they can jump. They are really good in melee and chasing, they are fast. Their jump cooldown is relatively low, so you can jump quite a lot. You can get the leader in with the Homunculus lab, and this gives you the tracking device. The tracking device gives vision for enemy squad for 20 or 30 seconds, as if it would be controlled by you. If the enemy has a true sight, you will also gain true sight. Really nice if you like disengaging, you can throw a tracking device and know where the enemy are. Really nice to have. In tier 2 you get access to two more squads, all from your Hall of Blood. It's the Scourge squad. The Scourge squad is very mobile by flying. It's really slow. It's similar to a Warp Spider. Really slow moving, but can jump. Have weapons that need to be stationary to fire. Really good anti-infantry in the start, but can get dark lenses, for example. So these are your go-to anti-vehicle units. You get them out, you get some dark lenses out, and that's your anti-vehicle. In Unification, you can also get heat lenses. Heat lenses are similar, I would say. Sorry, I would say to fusion guns, medium range, medium to long range, maybe a little longer. Very good. Slow reload than dark lenses. So these are a little longer range. These have slower, lower range, but deal more damage. And then you have this Haywire blasters. These are all also really good, but they have a longer range, are limited to 2. And your anti-titan weapon. It has maximum armor penetration, poor anti-infantry performance. That's yeah, explains by itself. It's really expensive. So if you have tier 2 and need to look out for the resources, get the dark lenses or the heat lenses, not the Haywire Blaster. The Haywire Blaster looks nice, has quite a long range. Yeah, good against bigger vehicles. Once you build your Witch arena, you get access to the Witch Squad. Witch Squad is relatively tanky for an Dark Elder. Has good damage ranged and melee. In melee, they are really good against enemy commanders. So if you see witches with your commander, run away, or the other way around. If you seeing a commander with the witches, try to focus it down in melee. All the melee weapons, including the different weapons from the witch leader here, Witch Succubus, are really, really good against commanders. Also, it detects infiltrators. And what's their most used for is their combat trucks ability. That's a little AoE around them, you see here, where the squads get trucks, or the units, models get trucks. The trucks make it so that they are morale immune for 15 seconds and have their attack speed increased by 30%, so it's quite a lot. If you have more Witch Squad, you can use this ability overlapping, you could say, this one, then after it's depleted 15 seconds, the second squad uses it, so you can get through the cooldown. Overall, it has a cooldown of 90 and has 15 seconds uptime, so you would need 4 witch squads in theory. I myself would suggest that you go no more than 3 witches, because they are tanky, but they don't deal as much damage as you would like. So they are more like a supporting, tanking squad that you can combine with some warriors or one of the later squads to give them the drugs out to make them more potent in combat. Another tier 2 unit, which is a new squad, are the Rex. You can't get a leader. The leader you need to get later in tier 3, I guess. These are melee specialists, are quite tanky. And what they are special about is that they get better the less HP they have. That's for each individual model. Where is it written down? I have it here. Where is it? There are several. Here. They get passives, more passive abilities than they get lower, they get more DPS, they receive less damage, they have morale damage, aura and whatnot. There's a really good wiki page for Dark Elder already, which explains all the different abilities they have access to. So they get harder to kill and deal more damage the less HP they have. So really nice frontline unit in that sense. Something that Elder really needs, to be honest. It's limited to 1, so it's also tier 2. So get maybe 2 witch squad and 1 wreck, and then you have your front line secured. Witches are performing also really good in range. The range isn't the biggest, but still. So you can have them in between melee and range squads and use the combat drug ability to maximum effect. A tier 3 squad you have access to are the Warp Beasts. The Warp Beasts are really, really, really tankry. They are stating here Demon, but the armor type, at least in vanilla, is Heavy Infantry. Not sure if it has been changed here. They have one problem though. If their morale is broken, they become uncontrollable, attack each other, and after a time they attack your squads as well. You can get the Beastmaster leader for them, which gets the ability Tame Warp Beast, basically a rally ability, so they will fight for you again. So highly suggested that you get the Beastmaster as soon as you have the squad on the field. I'm not sure if it's limited to 1 or 2. Normally you don't get more than 1 of it, because they're mostly tanky. They deal damage as well, but yeah, I wouldn't go for more than 1 of these. And lastly, you have another new squad, the Trueborn. The Trueborn is a tier 3 heavy infantry range squad. Very, very good. Has a lot of HP, a lot of damage in ranged. Has 7 models, a leader, the Dracon. So it's a hero leader. Where is it here? Can use Terrorfax grenades. Something I forgot about the Warriors. I will talk about it now. The Warriors also have access to Terrorfax grenade once they have their leader. Terrorfax grenade does deal no no HP damage to the enemy, only morale damage, as well as morale damage over time, and mostly reduce the sight and detection range by 90%. So if you can get Terrorfax grenades hits on multiple squads, they won't see far, which is really nice to have. They have various different weapons, ranging from splinter cannons, which is pretty good against infantry and demons. Also the shredder rifle, similar to the warrior squads, as well as the dark matter blaster, but also dark lances, so they can get anti-infantry or anti-vehicle or anti-everything weaponry, depending on what you need. All of the squads here, including your heroes, can get poison weaponry with an upgrade. Poison weaponry deals 3 damage over the time of 10 seconds. It's reduced by armor, but still it's an additional weapon damage source if you want to see it as that. I would suggest to always get it if you have some melee squads. Also is applicable against buildings and vehicles, so I would go for it as long as I have some melee squads going around. That's the infantry. Let's talk about vehicles. You have access to 1 tier 1 vehicle, that's the Reaver jet bike. Reaver Jet by itself does okay damage. It has really, really poor accuracy on the move. It's really fast, so you would need to micro it to stay close to the enemy and then shoot. Has no melee attack, so it will always use this a little ranged attack here. It has a tier 2 upgrade, which increases the damage on the move and general damage accuracy quite a bit, so it increases the damage you can deal. And it's also affected by the HP upgrades. You have two HP upgrades for vehicles, one in tier 2 and one in tier 3. So it stays relevant even in late game. Then you have a very special transport vehicle, the Raider. The Raider is a fast moving vehicle, like a skimmer, like it's floating around. That's one that I say. It can transport stuff and it can jump, but it's not a normal jump. If it jumps, it makes this little boom when on the ground, which does knockback and quite a lot of morale damage. But what is the coolest part of it is that units can shoot out of it while they're inside. If we see these warriors here, if they go inside, up to 6 models takes place there and shoot out. Due to that, it is really hard coded. Is that if you have strato rifles, you can't use them because the technics is that this vehicle has all the different weapons these units have also available, and once there are 6 units inside, these weapons are activated. It's hard coded, so you cannot add strato rifles. The best use I have seen in some pro player is that you get the Archon with as much incubus you can get and put it inside here, because it can be killed, can't be killed there, and then you have the different rifles. If you get the shredder rifle upgrade for your commanders, you have also a shredder rifle here. So you have a fast moving vehicle with all the incubus, very good ranged attacks I was talking about earlier, how the damage spread is really good and whatnot. And if you want to pop out, use one of the few abilities and then hop in again. So that's the best use I have in mind. Also useful if you have warriors coming into tier 2, which are sometimes too frail in tier 2, just putting in a raider and move around. But for the most time, people tend to get the Venom. The Venom is a tier 2 vehicle that has very, very good anti-infantry and anti-demon capabilities. It's limited to 2 and can also transport some stuff around. Very fast, very high damage, can get also a heat lens against anti-vehicle. Very strong right now, but it's frail as all the Dark Elder stuff is, so I don't think it's as overpowered. It maybe needs a little tone down in the damage, but overall a really nice unit, limited to 2. In tier 2 you can also get for a Talos, which is a melee based vehicle like a Scorpion. Flying Scorpion does a hell of a lot of melee damage. Some range damage as well, and can get this Wildfire ability, which he shoots balls in random directions around, dealing quite a lot of damage. Needs to be recharged though, and can also harvest soul essence, but it's like 4 or 5 times faster than a slave. So if you want to have a lot of soul essence, maybe you are after a fight and don't want to pursue the enemy but have some bodies lying around, use this harvest soul essence to get quite a lot of soul essence. I cannot overstate how big the DPS in melee this unit has. In tier 4 you get access to the Ravager. The Ravager is a really fast vehicle, as almost all vehicles. I mean, the Talos isn't the fastest, but all the others are really fast. Anti-vehicle, anti-building has this 3 different weaporry here. Has a Horrorfax bomb you can throw. Horrorfax bomb has a little AoE morale damage, but also a fear component for 8 seconds. So if you want to get rid of some enemy infantry, you can throw that as well. You can upgrade disintegrators on all the different weapons, which makes this to an anti-infantry vehicle instead of an anti-vehicle. You see, it changes the weapons from all the 3 here. And then you have the relic units, the Dais of Destruction. The Dais of Destruction, you have this big guy sitting in here, having his 2 slave girls here sitting in front of him, and having quite a lot of guys, one who's the driver and 3 different guys shooting. Don't know if these guys shoot as well. Really fast, has an aura around it, so you see it here, which increased range damage taken by 30%. So it's a really nice support if you have a big ball of infantry or vehicles, stand it in the middle and it will get quite the buffs. You get access to the Dark Scythe ability, which looks really nice. So this guy does now this 180 degree scythe, which does a lot of damage against all armor types except air, because it does not hit air. Has a quite a long cooldown. Has weapons to fight infantry and vehicles. It has a dark lens as some shredder rifles. I think this is the dark lens and these are the shredder or disintegrators. Yeah, these are the disintegrators. They look like this. Two disintegrators on each side and one dark lens at the front. The new unit, the new Titan killer unit, is the Reaper. The Reaper is, as all vehicles, relatively slow. Relatively fast. Is meant to kill Titans. The range is really good, as you can see. And has only one singular large rifle here at the front, and also has one disintegrator as well. But this is the Titan killer gun here. Does it say what it's called? Storm Vortex Projector Cannon. So this is meant to kill Titans. Every vanilla faction has a Titan and a Titan killer unit or weaponry for one of the units. This is the Titan killer. These are all the vehicles. Let's talk about the different aircraft. You have actually... I forgot to build one. There are three air units. One, the first one I'm building now, the Raven. We will look at it once it's out. It is an anti-vehicle or anti-aircraft unit. It has a LAS dark lens, which only can attack air, and has a shredder rifle against infantry on the ground. So it if you target ground units, target infantry. If you target air units, you target air units. So really good about that. And has one ability, which is the short circuit ability, which is basically a EMP for buildings and buildings as well. Okay, it's not only vehicles but also buildings. Later I wasn't aware of. So you can use it to arrest buildings as well. You use the short circuit so that listening posts, for example, won't fire back. Your Razorwing Jetfight is a tier 3 unit. You need a relic unit for it as well. It's an aircraft which is good against buildings, vehicles and aircraft, so an anti vehicle stuff. Very durable it states. Has no special abilities. Two dark lenses and a splinter cannon. So really good against vehicles, but also the splinter cannon also has some anti-infantry components to them. And last but not least, they are Titan, the Void Raven Bomber. The Void Raven Bomber is really big, it's really fast for a Titan, and it can fly, so it's really, really mobile. Very nice Titan unit, if you ask me. Has weapons to fight basically everything, but it looks like, you can choose. You can have implosion missiles or shatterfield missiles. If you have it off like this, you have the implosion missiles, which are anti-armor, anti-aircraft, very long range. But you can also get shatterfield missiles, which are your anti-infantry round, very long range as well, AOE. So you can use this. And you have access to Void Mine. Void Mine, you can only use it once per battle. Each Void Raven Bomber can only drop a singular of these. If this one dies and you build another one, which you normally don't want to have happen, you will probably get another Void Mine as well. You can click this somewhere and does quite a lot of damage. We will fly over to the enemy command and see how much damage it does against HQ. But it's basically a huge bomb. What does it say? Almost all infantry units caught in the blast are reduced into floating molecules. Okay, same is true for vehicles. Only the greatest of them have a chance to survive. So it's a big, big boom. Costs a lot of power. Let's see if we drop it here on the HQ. Holy shit! What? 4,000 damage on an HQ. Wow. Oh, Okay, so that's why you can only use it once. I mean, imagine a team game where a big fight is going on, then a Void Raven just comes about, drops a Void Mine, and you win. That's an I win button, if you ask me. In 1-on-1 especially, if you are able to get to Titans, which is basically never, you can use it on the enemy economy. There are like 5 generators standing around, and a listening post, and maybe some turrets. Boom! All gone. No eco for them enemy. Or just kill the whole enemy army with one click. Wow. I mean, but you need to get to Titans. The Void Raven itself costs 600 power, and then you need to get another 400 power to the Void Mine. So I see where it comes from. just so you know, it's really, really, really strong. Okay. That's the units. Next up, we will go to Detective, where I will tell you about the different upgrades and how to tech up. So see you there. And here's the tech tree. As usual, you will find that on my Google Drive that I always link under this videos. For your understanding, the things that are with red are the things that are added in Unification. Everything with red is the base game. As always, I want to talk about 3 things. 1, how to tech up. To tech up to tier 2, you need either the Dark Foundry or the Hall of Blood, which is really nice, so you don't need to get both or need a Homunculus lab or anything. You can get really fast tier 2 if you want to. In tier 2, you need to get the Witch Cult Arena, which is the only tier 2 building to get up. Then you can tech to tier 3. And I think the Soul Cage, does it has a real? No. Then you can just build a Soul Cage directly after to get to tier 4. There are several upgrades for units. Let's start the one in your barracks. You can get invisibility for your Mandrakes in tier 1, and you can get all the different war gears for your commander. In the Dark Foundry, there are a lot of cool upgrades as well. This one is the accuracy / damage upgrades for your jet bikes, and this one is your upgrade, your durability upgrade. It's not only HP, it's also some passive, I think. I need to look that up and maybe even include it in the tech tree here for units. Has 2 stages here. In tier 3, you can also get the ability for your Talos, which is a tier 2.5 unit otherwise. And yeah, that's these upgrades. The last upgrades you have access to are either in the Homunculus lab or from your Witch Cult arena. Interesting is that you can get a lot of upgrades in tier 1. There are a lot of factions which get most of the upgrades in tier 2, but Dark Elder are an exception. You can get the Poison Blades, you can get the Splinter Cannon upgrades for your squad leaders and heroes. This one is Soulseeker ammunition, which increases the accuracy of almost all ranged weaponry of Dark Elders, so it's basically a damage increase of almost all weapons. So if you're playing a heavy tier 1 with infantry, I highly suggest getting this. It's not cheap, but it's very useful. This is one of the 3 upgrades for your Archon to get more Incubus. You see there's in every tier is 1 upgrade till tier 3 to get an additional Incubus in the squad and even increasing its stats. And this is a power knife, power blade weapon for your leaders and squad leaders. There's a second stage of this is the Agonizers, which is similar to a Power Fist, but not. Has a lot of morale damage and is really strong. So this is for your melee leaders and squad leaders. And you have 1 singular armor upgrade, which increases HP of almost all infantry you have. Very useful. If you play with infantry, which most of the games you are, get this. And this is the damage and HP upgrade for Mandrakes. Only useful if you have quite a lot of Mandrakes on the field. To keep them viable in tier 2 and onwards. The upgrades from the Witch Cult Arena are really self-explanatory. These 3 are the abilities for your Archon, and these 2 for your Homunculus. And this is the leader HP upgrade 1 you get in tier 2 and another one in tier 3. That's basically that. I have added here this Peasant Booby Trap building I was talking about with the Lesser Warp Beast and turret you can get access to in Survival. Okay. That's that. Here I want to only talk about how organized the tech tree is. You have all the different weapons you can have access to. For infantry, you need the Dark Foundry. All the different squad leaders for your infantry, you need a homunculus lab. So it's really, really organized, really easy to understand. One exception is the wreck. Here it needs to get tier 3 to get the special leader, but other than that, it's basically dead and some ability upgrades for your units. Really, really easy to understand. Which also shows how good Dark Elder are on tier 1, because they have access to so much stuff on tier 1. Their squad leaders, they have with their shredder, is it shredder, whatever they are, their weapon upgrade here. Give me a second. This one, this also have some anti-vehicle components as well as these power knives here. So they have even some anti-vehicle, anti-building in tier 1.5. So really, really good. If you want some dedicated anti-vehicle in the Scorches, for example, you need to get to tier 2, of course, but still very, very good tier 1. Let's talk about the Honor Guard and bonus squads. You can get an homunculus in the campaign, which has similar to the different casters you get as Honor Guards as well, has access to all his abilities right away, which is nice. The Mantric Honor Guard you can get has directly access to infiltration. Your Warriors Super Right, I hope I pronounced it correctly, is basically a leader squad, so you get immediately access to the Haywire Grenade, similar to the Hellion leader squad. You get immediately access to the Seeker thing here. Then you have an Incubo only squad, which has no abilities apart from the poison you can get on their melee weapons, of course. You have a leader squad of, what are they called again? Scorches. So you don't get a leader for them. They are the leaders, and you can get the weapons as you would normally get for them as well. Then you have a witch leader squad. Yeah, has all the abilities. And this one is really funny. It's the War Beast, and it's only one. So you can't get the Beastmaster. So when the morale for this bad boy is dropped, it will attack you and cannot be turned down unless waiting for it regaining its regaining its morale. In campaign, you can also get access to a jetpack and a raider, which are in functionality the same. In survival, you can also get access to another trooper on squad, which is otherwise limited to one, to a Ravager, which is normally limited to two, Ravager, and another Dice of Destruction. One thing to note in survival that is that you get two squads in tier 1. In tier 1, you get a witch, and in tier 2, you get a scorch and the singular warp beast here. In tier 3, you get, let me think. I actually forgot what you get in tier 3. Ah, Troopborn, another Troopborn. In tier 4, a Ravager. And in tier, if you play harder and higher, you get another Dice of Destruction. Okay, that's the tech tree out of the way. And as I said, it's a really, how should I say, a lot of options in the early game. So you have quite a lot of options for your build orders as well, which we will see right now. And here we are. Looking at the build order document. The build order here that I call standard is one that I have seen quite a lot of pro games. That's why I call it standard. You could also call it a double hero play. Basically, you get two capping squads, no additional builder, because your builder can tick the buildings and then run to the next, so you don't really need to spend the 75 requisition in getting another builder. You get a Hall of Blood, a generator, one warrior, and the Archon. You later add another warrior squad, get the Sybarites, one you have the Homunculus lab, and get the various upgrades for your warriors and your leader unit. You can get the infiltration ability for your Mantrakes if you want to, have them support your army. If you do that, you can also get the poison weaponry if you want, and you can also, no you can't, it's all your 8 squad cap used up. If you want to get more warriors, you need to get a slave chamber. Then you normally, if you upgrade a few listening posts, you will need to get one or two more power generators before to get to tier two. Why you need it is because this shredder rifle, I think it's shredder rifle, I get all these names mixed up. This weapon upgrade here costs 75 power, this costs 40 power, and this costs 15 power. So we have quite a lot of power sinking in these upgrades as well, and the leader units, which also costs, I think, 20 power. So this is your standard. And yeah, of course you get your Homunculus as soon as you have your Homunculus lab, which costs also quite a lot of power, so you will need three of these bad boys. The Homunculus you can use to support your army with his first ability and put him in one of the warrior squads, so he is kind of protected. The second build order I have seen a lot is the Hellion Harris. Hellion Harris is really a slim build order. You can see here you can get the two cappers, you get a Dark Foundry and the Generator. The Generator is mandatory as your Hellions will also cost you power. The Dark Foundry costs 65 power, so you would be able to only get one Hellion, but you also want to reinforce them and whatnot. So get the Generator, get the two Hellions out, harass the enemy, get another gen out, play it. Yeah, just harass the enemy and get a quick tier 2. That's why I would normally build it. You can stay longer tier 1 if you get the Homunculus Lab and get some upgrades for the Hellions. If you want, you can get a Homunculus Lab and then the melee upgrade and whatnot if you want to stay longer in tier 1. But the Hellions, as soon as the enemy has some defenses up, the Hellions really become not as useful. So I see them more as a good way to keep the enemy busy, keep the enemy economy down so that you can hit tier 2 before the enemy. That's how I see this build. Another build is the jet bike. That's very, how should I say, a lot of people like it to play it. A lot of people hate to play against it. You get your standard 2 Mandrakes, get the Dark Foundry, a Generator, get one Hellion. And as soon as the Dark Foundry is up, you get a Homunculus Lab. And with that, you're now able to get jet bikes. You can get only 3 jet bikes in the beginning, so you would need to get a slave chamber to get 3 additional one. You can get another slave chamber to get even more, but I would suggest to get a maximum of 6 and then get everything ready to tier 2, where you get the upgrades for your jet bikes and all your vehicles in general. I added here a second builder because you have the slave chamber with the torture pit add-on, so you can get one builder all the time getting soul energy. I also kind of suggest to get the poison ability, as you have to build the Homunculus Lab anyway, and have some Hellions around the poison weapon can help in the fights quite a bit. The next one is a little meme. It's Mandrake Spam. Sorry for my voice. I'm still kind of recovering from my cold. You can get up to 4 Mandrakes because you have only 8 squad caps, so you can get 4 of these. You get a Hall of Blood for the infiltration. You can get so really, really early infiltrated capping squads, so you can play a little like Tau if you want to. Get a gen, of course, get your Homunculus Lab with the poison weaponry, so you now have infiltrated poison damage dealing Mandrakes. That's cool. So you can get make a little contain to the enemy, especially against factions that don't have a lot of detection. For example, if you fight Emperor's Children, this is a really nice build. Get another gen up and get to tier 2. In tier 2, you want to get the upgrade for the Mandrakes. If they are still alive, the one upgrade that's particularly used for the Mandrakes, but also you can get also the armor upgrade, which should also affect Mandrakes. So they get really tanky in tier 2. And if you get some witches to support them, you can have quite a force in tier 2. The fifth one is a build order. Okay, there's something missing. I need to add this. It's a build order that's limited to unification. Refiler made it popular with one of the videos he did. You get both. Sorry, a Hall of Blood and a Dark Foundry, so you can get the weapons for your warriors. You get only one Mandrake because this is really expensive, especially if you want to or need to get another gen as well. So you can get 2 warriors out immediately, get the weapon, the shredder rifle here immediately, and move out and try to deal as much damage to the enemy while you're slowly capping up your stuff. You want to get a slave chamber here as well, so you can get another squad. You can get another warrior squad later on, so these four would fill out your squad cap. But once you're committed to this, I recommend you get a slave chamber and build a fourth squad as well. I have here this dark matter blast ability as well, listed weapon listed here, because if you are in the enemy base and attacking buildings and stuff, this one can be really handy, as it is really good against buildings. And this one is up to personal preference. If you build a Humongous Lab or you go to tier 2 immediately. In my understanding, if you're committing to a tier 1 build and want to deal a lot of damage, you may as well build a Humongous Lab, get the Cyberite leader, get this weapon upgrade for your leaders and the Soul Seeker ammunition, so you have like really, really, really hard-hitting warriors. So that's my interpretation, but you can also skip this and get the earlier tier 2. Speaking of tier 2, you also have a tier 2 rush. You get only 2 mandrakes, and then you can decide if you get a Hall of Blood or a Dark Foundry. Hall of Blood is a cheaper tier 2, a faster tier 2, but a Dark Foundry takes a little longer for the tier 2, but then you have a Dark Foundry up and available already to get, for example, the transport vehicle, or if you add a Homunculus Lab on the way to tier 2, you can get up a quick Venoms, which is one of the best ways to use a tier 2 rush. As the usual, tier 2 rushes are really dangerous. If you get rushed by the opponent, you're probably dead. So that build order's out of the way. I will now jump into an example replay of, was it GPR? I have forgotten which players it were. So we will see an example replay here. I know, I remember. It's Refiler playing Dark Elder versus KPR playing Imperial Guard. So quite a good game. See you in a second. And here we are on the replay. As I said, KPR playing Imperial Guard versus Refiler playing Dark Elder. And we see KPR going for a tactical control opening. This will be interesting in a second. And as you see, you build a Hall of Blood, a Dark Foundry and Plasma Generator. Only one Mandrake, because you will be out of resources if you would build two. By this you can build two warrior squads right away. You have about 300 requisition, a little over 300 requisition once the Hall of Blood is finished. Everything getting built, nothing special here. Nice animations though. And there you go. One warrior on the way. Now he builds the listening post, and then he will have shortly enough resources for the second warrior squad. Mantrake getting the save cap. You could also, and there you see scan, that's why I mean why it's interesting that he starts with tactical control. You could argue that you send your Mantrakes first to cap this, and then your first warrior squad caps this while waiting on the second one, and he immediately gets a shutter rifle. So a little optimization in the cap order possible here. And now he has two squads out getting shutter rifles with increased range and more damage. But coming here, he immediately is greeted by a heavy bolter, and he does the right thing, just run away. There's no way these two warriors will be able to contest this point here, so he moves away. It's the right choice if you want to be aggressive but you can't at one position, go around, find another weak spot. Pretty much what he does. Other than that, he just builds the listening post as soon as he has enough resources. These weapon upgrades aren't cheap. If you get three of those, it costs 90 requisition and 30 power. So he gets another listening post. Now needs to go up here. That's a big problem here, that he's getting shot by grenade launchers. Won't be able to finish the cap here. Needs to tie them down. And he found another weak spot, the listening post. Capiao rushed this one, so this here is vulnerable here. He kills the tech priest and now should kill the listening post. That he does. Yeah, Mantrix just delaying here. With the slave chamber. Does he build a second? No. Should have built first the third audio spot and then the slave chamber. So your war squads are on the field earlier. Can now decap this. The Mantrix move to the north to cap these. Guardsman squad should get minced here. Yeah. They turn into melee, good choice. But in melee they will also lose, I think. And now he puts in the second squad to finish this squad probably. While capping here, should move the slave on top to get the listening post down. Has a little float here, should get the warrior squads. Okay, now he has a problem here. Guardsmen with grenade launchers. Either run away or engage. Builds a warrior squad, can build a second one shortly after. Has to reinforce, now he wants to reinforce, so that not only your models with the precious weapons get killed. Yeah, you can, if you have two squads, you can probably bring down one squad here, but lost quite a lot of models. Once whole squad goes down, this one will die eventually as well. There you go. Big losses here, but he can now slowly start to get his part of the map. He has the top, which is good. He now will take his side. Caviar needs to retake this. Has the middle. This is a bug, right? Yes, it is. It's only because Refiler didn't see it finish, so if you reveal the Fog of War, you don't see it. Okay, he takes this squad point, he gets his relic, and yeah, this point gets decapped, so he has another point of interest here. Gets two new squads now. Should get a third, if you ask me. In general, this is interesting to see that new build in action here. Two squads and a Mantrake. Send the Mantrake 4 to absorb shots and then move in with the warriors, I guess. You should also get some new models if it's just to get some more HP on the field to get some shots, so that not your precious models with the shadow rifles get focused by the enemy, so that some other models will take the damage instead. Morale broken, now going to the next squad. Yeah, the shredder rifles, look at the damage. They are a little too much for tier 1. So you can now decap this, can move and should cap this with some Mantrake sword and then see if this one got taken so far. I guess a command squad could deal with at least one of those. Having only guardsmen that run here and getting minced is probably not the right play. I mean, if you go tactical control opening, you're very limited. You can only build three guardsmen with grenade launchers and a sergeant. That's pretty much it what you can do. If you want to do something else, you need to add stuff. He did not. He got for a raw tier 2 with them. I mean, you can get upgrades for your guardsmen, of course. 1, 2, 3, 4. Four squads now. No more squad cap. Should save resources for tier 2 now. And he has a lot of power, so maybe he should upgrade some of these towers. At least 2, if you ask me. Boom. He has basically the whole map, apart from the middle, where the turret is standing. Can't really take this one, but should go to the side here, yes. Does he upgrade something here? Yeah. And he can upgrade and should upgrade another one. that would bring his power in a position where he can still tech up. Oh, did he notice it? He put the true sight ability on this squad to see the mines. The sixth sense activated there. Awesome.
Victory countdown.
Should move down to take this. He upgraded the second one, right? Come on, where did your power go then? Ah, okay, he goes for tier 2. Should upgrade listening post. He has the resources to do so. I mean, you can save power, but if you upgrade your stuff early, it will pay for itself rather quickly. He can now, okay, get this critical. He could also get this critical location. Has 3 squads now. Yes, 3 squads here. Not sure. Upgrade listening post, probably not a good idea. He has also a mine, but he does not have enough soul essence to use the detector ability, so should just take this strategic point fully, I guess. And then make sure he has some anti-vehicle going on. Hemolucus Laboratory is the good transition here. He needs to get here too to get some dedicated anti-vehicle out, and with the Hemolucus Laboratory he can upgrade his existing infantry troops, and can also the upgrades will also benefit his newly built probably Scorches, I guess. Yeah, there's a mechanized command. He sees it with the critical location. That's the thing with critical locations. They have a really big sight range. And there are the sentinels. First sentinel out. He hit tier 2, and there are the Scorches. Very, very nice. Will make short work out of the sentinel slash maybe sentinels. Sentinels would need to make big work. They should. Don't know if putting them directly in the enemy base is a good idea, or if they should rather try to take the outer points and then cap them and get a position back on the map. I'm not sure. But the Scorches are out. He gets the Haywire Blasters and then the Heat Lances flying in. Only has one of these. There's a really nice effect, like a lightning here. Now having 2 lightnings. Not as good against vehicle light. I think this is light vehicle. It has some stasis effect, right? Power Lucina, I recommend it. Energy drawn from other immensely powerful. Doesn't state it, but it has this effect here. Does it slow? Would be interesting. He has the Hemolucus Laboratory. I would suggest adding the Silver Rights and the Shredder Rifles, or what they call. Look at the damage. They also deal quite a lot of damage against light vehicles. Just look at it. They are way too good, if you ask me. But okay, at least they should get a tier 2 tech on them, at least to what the gentleman's rules will say. So I will adjust that in the gentleman's rules. And yeah, that's the video. That's the example replay where you see the new build order in action. And it's nice to see the new one because you have quite a lot of Pro Vanilla Dawn of War replays if you want to see them in the webs, where you see a standard openers like Jetbike opener, Hellion opener, Double Hero opener, all that stuff, tier 2 rush. There are a lot of different casts even of these replays. So if you want to see them in action, you can search the webs for it. Okay, that finishes my guide for the Dark Elder. If you have something to add, just let me know in the comments. If I have forgot something, let me know in the comments. If you liked it or did not like it, leave a comment. You see a pattern there, right? As always here, I would say thanks for watching, guys, and see you in the next video. Bye bye.